Imagine the ability to interact with something across any distance of space instantly. What could be accomplished if humanity can control this spooky action at a distance?
First of all, Albert Einstein hated quantum entanglement. He called it spooky action at a distance. He couldn't get his head around it, but hey, Einstein was wrong. We do this every day in the laboratory.
One of the strangest discoveries in all of physics came in the early 20th century, accompanying the breakthrough into the quantum realm. Early on in the development of quantum physics, scientists discovered an aspect of subatomic particles that they called entanglement. This bizarre property of quantum particles somehow allows them to send information to an entangled pair instantly, meaning if we observe one particle in an entangled pair here on Earth and interact with it, the other entangled particle will react instantly, no matter how many light years are between them. Two entangled particles are connected through a mysterious and impossibly fast communication channel. When this phenomenon was first introduced to the scientific community, scientists, like Einstein, were weirded out enough to hate entanglement and gave it the name spooky action at a distance. Since then, scientists who had reservations have had to come to terms with its existence as the quantum world has continued to throw surprises our way. The fact that electrons and other particles can be entangled is not new information, but two recent studies have shown entanglement occurring between devices that can nearly be seen with the naked eye. But what is quantum entanglement exactly, and how does it work? How can two distant particles lose their independence and become entangled? In order to understand entanglement, we need to understand more about a special property that electrons and nearly all other quantum particles have: spin. When physicists talk about a particle's spin, they do not mean that the particles are literally spinning. Spin is just the name for an intrinsic property many subatomic particles have, a type of angular momentum. The spin of a particle has properties and interactions somewhat similar to a tiny magnet. Every particle that has spin will have one or two possible orientations, either spin up or spin down. Imagine a scenario in which an electron is whizzing through a magnetic field generated by a pair of north and south magnetic poles. Depending on the spin of that electron, it will either be deflected up towards the north pole or down towards the south pole of the magnet. The electrons whose spin is up will be the ones deflected towards the north pole, while those whose spin is down will be deflected towards the south pole. In an extra dose of quantum weirdness that has to do with Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, it is impossible to measure a particle's spin along more than one axis at a time. Could the spin of a particle be different along different axes when our measurements are made? Unfortunately, we will never know the answer to this, because quantum mechanics asserts that the effects of the detectors used to measure spin are inherently a property of spin itself, and therefore, as soon as a particle's spin along one axis is known and defined, the spin along the other axis becomes undefined and unknowable. In a pair of entangled particles, one will be spin up and one will be spin down. If one of these particles was affected in a way to flip that spin, its entangled partner would flip its spin instantly. How are these particles able to interact with each other? Was there something that physicists were missing? The proof that entanglement was real wouldn't come until the mid-1960s, when Bell developed a testable hypothesis to finally be able to know if entanglement was real. His goal was to understand if the quantum world followed local realistic models in which particles interact only with those around it, or if the quantum world was truly weird and allowed for non-local interactions across vast distances. Bell introduced what he called hidden variables, which are hypothetical properties ingrained in quantum particles that act non-localizing, allowing entangled particles to interact with each other instantly, no matter the space between them. From his work arose the now famous Bell's Inequality Theorem, which was a carefully formulated inequality that could be experimentally tested to prove if the quantum world acts locally or non-locally. Bell's inequality theorem is elegant and influential enough to the scientific world as a whole to have its own video, so now we'll jump to the early 1970s, when the first experiment was designed to test this theory and prove the reality of quantum entanglement. Since then, many additional studies have been conducted that have reinforced these results again and again. Recently, there have been two research groups with the ultimate goal of scaling up entanglement in an attempt to create entangled objects that can be seen with the naked eye. One group, based in the Netherlands, is working on using silicon computer chips and etching beams as a mere 10 micrometers long, approximately the size of the average bacteria, almost to a visible size. They were able to shoot carefully calibrated laser pulses to energize one of the beams, causing it to vibrate more than the others. This in turn gave off light within the apparatus, which could be measured and studied by the team to verify this energetic boost. The apparatus was designed to not allow the researchers to know which beam was energized. They were only able to see that there had been added energy. After this process, they looked at the microchip and saw that the energy added to one beam had been shared by both of them. This was the result they were hoping for, proving that they had in fact created an entangled pair that could almost be seen without a microscope. While it only lasted a fraction of a second, these results gave a lot of hope to those trying to create macroscopic entangled objects. Another team of physicists in Finland are taking a slightly different approach to find out whether or not macroscopic objects can become entangled. Instead of putting a pair of entangled beams on a chip, they developed tiny aluminium drum heads that are the same width as a human hair, about 17 microns. Using microwaves, the drum heads were nudged into correlated motion with each other, both throbbing up and down following opposite patterns. Similarly to the first experiment, they sent a second set of microwave pulses to one of the drums. This pulse added just the right amount of energy to one of the drums that, if shared with its pair, would nudge them into the same quantum state, following the same pattern and proving they were entangled. Once the information from the set of drums was analyzed, this is exactly what they found, proving that they had succeeded in creating an entangled pair. In another bit of weirdness from this study, they found that this form of entanglement can last for an indefinite amount of time, given that the drum heads stay immersed in the bath of microwaves. Does this mean that it is possible for two objects to exchange information with each other across any distance? Could this be used for instant transmissions, for the fastest form of communications possible? Would these lead to better quantum computers and the dawn of quantum internet? One physicist out of Nottingham, Andrew Armour, asked the very important question, how far can you go up in scale? Could this form of instant information transfer lead to more futuristic advancements in other forms of teleportation? Only future studies into the quantum world will show us what is possible using the bizarre and sometimes frightening features of quantum mechanics. Thanks for watching. Leave a comment down below and let us know what you think about the weirdness of the quantum world. And if you have a quantum phenomenon that fascinates you the most, see you next time on Matter.